Skinky, but skinky, believe me, I know it. You've lost that loving feeling. Oh, that loving feel. Okay, I can't do it anymore. Hey guys, today we're gonna talk about anthropomorphism, the idea of projecting human-like traits, attributes, and characteristics onto animals and non-human objects. Hi, I'm TC Houston, former zookeeper and lifelong reptile enthusiast. And you're watching my channel called Reptile Mountain TV, a place where I can share evidence-based practices, keeping and breeding blue-tongue skinks, and a few others just for fun. Guys, you made it through my singing and you're still watching. Thanks so much. Today, we're going to talk about anthropomorphism. It is the idea of ascribing or assigning human traits, characteristics, and emotions to animals and non-human objects. Anthropomorphism occurs often in our daily lives, and it's a normal thing for a lot of us to do because we have a human mind. For example, a lot of us probably anthropomorphize our cars. Like, this is my girl who's been assigned a gender and a name. This is Bullet. And not only that, but we see that in kids' TV shows as well, and in children literature, and sometimes it's considered personification, which is slightly different but very similar to anthropomorphism, such as Mickey Mouse or even Tigger, or Disney shows like Finding Nemo. We will see human traits projected on to non-humans and animals. One of the things that happens in anthropomorphism is that people dress up their pets. They put sweaters on their animals. I'm guilty of putting a Christmas sweater on my Gila monster once for a Christmas photo. The Gila was fine, it didn't impact the animal, there was no adverse impact, and the photo got lots of likes. Yay. So, you know, some folks we project by just, you know, dressing up our animals. I don't really do that much. That was the one time in, I think, my entire life I've ever done such a thing, and I don't know why I did it, but I did it. That doesn't impact the reptile community and the animal nearly as much as projecting human-like emotions onto the animals. So, I want to talk about that. It's important to understand whether they do or don't have the emotions so that we know whether we are or not projecting, because it's not projection if they actually have the emotion. It's just calling it what it is. But if they don't have the emotion, it is projection. For example, I would be projecting onto my car by saying that Bullet, my car, is happy because she got a drink of gas. That is pure projection, because we know that Bullet has no capacity for high level emotion or any emotion at all. So any emotion I project is purely anthropomorphic. However, if I were to say that one of the killer whales at SeaWorld or at one of those famous parks is happy or unhappy, or has love for their child, or dislikes a keeper or a trainer, that could be very valid, because research has shown that Orcneus orca, the killer whale, has an actual greater capacity than humans for emotions. That makes it not anthropomorphism, but just calling it what it is. So it's important to determine whether they do or don't when it comes to reptiles. So please check out this little video skit I've put together on reptile emotional capacity and their intelligence. When it comes to reptiles, there are lots of comments that people like to share, such as, we hardly know anything about human emotion. So how can we say we know anything about reptile emotion? Well, saying we hardly know anything is inaccurate, to say the least. There are folks out there that have degrees upon degrees
learning about human emotion. There are libraries full of knowledge about human emotion. We know a ton about it, and we can use that knowledge then to determine how it correlates to reptile emotion. Or, my skink comes to me when I walk in the room. How is that not love? Well, that's a misinterpretation of behavior. Please see the links in the description and up above to learn more about behavioral misinterpretations. Here's another example of misinterpreted behavior. My snake loves to hang on my neck while I do chores around the house. He is certainly smart enough to know how to hold on and enjoy. Well, again, it's a slight misinterpretation of behavior. So with all these different comments and opinions on behavior and on intelligence, we want to really look at what this little skink here, this blue tongue skink, has as far as thoughts and knowledge. We want to know, really, Skinky LaRue, what are you thinking? Is it something primitive? Or is it something profound? Could it just be emotion? Or is it simple? Skinky LaRue, what are you thinking about? Well, there is plenty of evidence out there to support the fact that reptiles do have some form of intelligence. They are able to have cognition, to think, and to respond to stimulus, including be target trained, like this one, iguana at the San Diego Zoo. Many of you have seen the video. But having intelligence, to some extent, does not mean that you automatically get all the emotions or emoticons for the social media repertoire. So, we can't look at behavior because behavior can be incredibly misleading on its own. So we have to look for the parts. By looking at the parts of the brain that have been scientifically associated with emotion and producing emotion, we are doing our due diligence. Here's an example. If I say that I love chocolate ice cream, it's my favorite flavor of all time, but then I don't have taste buds, well, my flavor choice is kind of moot. Now, what we want to look for in a brain or in mental capacity is cortical folding, the insular cortex, limbic lobe, the frontal operculum or frontal lobe. Also, we want to look for the ability, which all these produce, is the cognitive ability to have cognitive appraisal. That's something significant. Also, we want to look at the gyrus, and we want to look at the limbic and paralimbic clefts, if they're present or not. All these things together have been associated with working in collaboration to enable the establishment of emotions in the highest level. So when we look at the parts and we want to compare the parts, what the parts do is they produce a product. And if we don't have the right product, we don't get the same outcome. So it's fair to say that Skinky LaRue probably has likes and dislikes, pains and pleasures, and that's about it.
Well, I hope you liked that little lecture doodle that I put together. That was a lot of work, actually. I'm no artist, by the way, or singer. We've established that through this video. Anyway, what it kind of brings out is that reptiles, they have more rudimentary preferences. They can have particular idiosyncrasies, things that they are more inclined to prefer or not prefer. And they can learn to an extent, but they don't have that high level cognitive appraisal, which assigns emotive value to the thing that they like. So, you know, they may like snails. It doesn't mean that they're in love with eating snails. There's an additional piece that's added on that they don't have. So with that in mind, let's get into talking about the positives and negatives and the outcomes from those in the reptile community. one of the positives that I see coming out of anthropomorphism is an increased level of care, heightened care. And I don't mean, quick, before anyone freaks out, if you are caring for the animal strictly based on biology and you're giving them 100% of what they're needing, then they are getting 100% A+ perfect care, okay? That's beyond discussion. What happens when I see anthropomorphism get involved is that they project folks will project an emotion onto the animal and then respond to that emotion and give 120% or 150%. And you can give that with science as well. However, what I'd really just see is that when somebody, a human, and it's human's nature's default. If we see something that's more like us, we see that emotion, we respond to that emotion more passionately than if we didn't see that emotion. Not to say that the science and strictly biology and strictly care is somehow substandard. Absolutely not. That is not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that usually anthropomorphism has a result of care that's kind of over the top, which can be okay. There was a video going around about a guy singing to his skink on his skink's birthday, and he made the skink a little platter. I think he made two videos, one first birthday and a second birthday, and they had these little platter of food, and the skink was a healthy, happy skink. And I say happy as in the skink had all its needs met and then some, and the owner was projecting emotion onto the animal, but that was okay because it just benefited the animal and there was no harm, no foul. And I find that that is one of the positives coming out of anthropomorphism. A very close related positive to an increased level of empathy or over-the-top care is usually a little bit of over-the-top advocacy. Folks will see emotion in the animal and then they will be more passionate towards advocating for that animal. Even when the emotion's not really there, they're still advocating for the animal and the animal benefits. Just like, a pet shelter, if someone feels like the dog is sad and depressed, they may donate more. Whether the dog's sad and depressed or just looking that way doesn't make a difference to the shelter. The shelter's gaining some sort of benefit, as well as when people donate for conservation funds, you know, whether the folks are delusionary or based strictly in reality, if the donations are coming in, I doubt that the conservationists really care. So I see it as a positive when folks kind of see emotions in the animal and then react more passionately. Not that scientists aren't passionate on their own. Trust me, there's plenty of passion in science on its own. However, folks that are, you know, touchy-feely and stuff, and they're reacting with emotion, that's great. It's an additional person advocating for the animal. I see that as a positive. Now, like those two positives, anything in excess can kind of get a little bit out of hand. And so, one of the things that I see as a negative is when those two positive things get a little bit out of control. For example, someone who would project emotion onto their animal and then respond with better care. And then they take that subjective care plan, the standard of care in keeping, and they project that out to the community. That's the biggest negative that I see as a problem in the reptile keeping community with anthropomorphism. It's no big deal if you feel like your skink loves you. That's great. It's not going to really mess up anybody's day. If you put a hat on the skink's probably going to be fine as long as you're not super gluing it, and nobody is going to be harmed. However, there is a piece of anthropomorphism that becomes toxic poison to the reptile keeping community, and it gets into the form of the subjective opinion of standard of care. Because when someone projects onto their animal and then they take that projection as the new standard and then they present it to the community as that should be the standard with no evidence behind it, You know, hey, if they've got a new idea and they put some evidence and establish practice to it and they show it and they say, hey, that's good, maybe the community will adopt it. That's different. That's not the same thing. That's an objective view of trying to advance the hobby, as opposed to a subjective view of someone saying, hey, my opinion about my skink loving me is the opinion, and therefore all you guys out there need to conform to the way I see my animal and I see the world. That is slightly egotistical and incredibly toxic, because a subjective standard of care is just that, subjective, and it cannot be sustained globally. The animals are the same animals, whether they're in Australia, Europe, China, Indonesia, South America, North America. It does not matter where the animal is in the world. It doesn't matter what community they are in, and it doesn't matter what keeper they have. Their needs are still biological needs. They don't change just because they crossed an international date line. So the fact is that when we project subjective opinions and subjective things such as anthropomorphism onto our animal and then present it as the new standard without established practice, without evidence to support it, we are diluting what the real standard is. And then we get into infighting and disagreements based on subjectivity, not objectivity. And it just poisons the entire community. And that is one of the number one reasons that I prefer to avoid anthropomorphism, and I don't respect it as something that is valuable to the community. Thank you guys for sticking around through this video and putting up with my drawings and my singing. We've grown to over 200 subscribers, which is amazing. 200 and something subscribers in 2 months and about 30 something videos. I'll take it. Thank you guys so much. Not bad for a guy with an iPhone 6, right? So please stay tuned for other videos. We've got some coming up on genetics. We've got some coming up on morphs, or visual traits, if you will. Some coming up on thermal regulation, on substrate for blue tongue skinks, rosy boa care, and a whole bunch more. So as always, please hit that like button if you like it. If you didn't like it and you hit the dislike button, write a comment and let me know why so I can improve. Also, if you're interested, share this video with other folks. And if you think it's worthwhile, shoot it around the internet. I don't mind. I'd be grateful. So I hope to see you on a future episode.